Good morning, everyone. It's so nice to see all of you. Thank you for joining me. Today, we're going to do some drawing. And why don't we just introduce ourselves? So I'm Lauren Renzetti, and I'm a gallery instructor at the AGO. And go ahead and jump in, Doris.
My name is Doris, and I'm an art educator at the AGO.
Nice. Thank you.
I'm Lori, and I'm a volunteer gallery guide at the AGO.
Lovely.
And I'm Carolyn, and Lori and I work together at the AGO as a gallery guide.
That's great. Yeah. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen, and I'm going to show you some works of art that you've already talked about together, but just so that the rest of the audience can see where we're at. So we have two artists that we're looking at today. We're looking at Helen McNicoll, and these I thought were really wonderful sketches of picking flowers. And I actually really love the sketch, I think even more so than the painting. But what's interesting is the way the brush strokes have been very impressionistic, just a quick moment in time. Kids never sit still. So we know that this was probably just a fleeting moment. And the painting on the right with the picking flowers has a beautiful shadow at the bottom, which is just exquisite. And that's something that I'm definitely going to be playing up in the drawing I'm doing today. The other thing that she really did that was quite wonderful is interior views. And in the, late 1800s, early 1900s, to paint a bedroom that's messy is a very intimate experience. And so to do a drawing of a room is an excellent thing to do when you're in isolation. And it's a lovely piece, but it's a little complicated to draw today. So we're just looking at it to kind of go, oh, someday I'm going to draw a part of my house. but I really like the way she's very impressionistic with how she's doing flowers in the moment, her fabrics, and even just the quick little bucket that's holding the grain for the chickens is all just so poignant and a lovely impressionistic moment. Now, Mary Reid has a very different take on painting, and she's quite, the thing that I really like about her work is that she's got these very beautiful setups. Now, I don't actually have a wall behind my drawing, my objects, but she does. And she really sets them up beautifully. Like the chrysanthemums has this beautiful Japanese nature in the actual ceramics, and then a lovely little painting behind it. And it's just such a beautiful composition because some of the flowers are wilting, and yet they're all in different angles. So it's really beautiful views of the flowers. And with the studies in grays, we have this beautiful roughed in scumble in the background behind the plate, and the light sources are really quite gorgeous too. And the polished surface, right? That's a really high polish. You can tell she spent a lot of time making that table exactly as shiny as possible. And then I wanted to finish with this one because it's just a very quick sort of painted sketch of daisies. And I just love the diagonals in the background. So if you are using chalk pastel, it's an exquisite way to kind of show off all the values in your palette that you have of pastels or pencil crayons or chalk pastels. Mm-hmm. And then being really, really crisp and strong with the whites on top. In particular, that top right corner flower is so beautiful with the juxtaposition of the really dark gray beside the extreme white. And yet it's the daisy that's looking away, which is really quite a nice feature to it. So we're going to be using, it doesn't matter to me what your still life objects are, but maybe you each can share what it is that you have that you're going to be drawing with, the tools you're drawing with, and the still life. And maybe we'll do it in alphabetical order. Mm-hmm. So Doris, if you want to go first, that would be lovely.
All right. So yeah, I'm gonna turn my my screen. Okay. And I think I have to go this way. I'll just be a bit of a side view here.
Okay.
And I'm gonna go down.
Yeah.
Can you see that?
Yeah. Okay, so we have plant life. That's lovely.
Yeah.
All right, with drapery in there. That's great. And what materials are you using today?
All right, so this is a fabulous package. I'm talking it's a little bit old.
Yeah.
I think it's 70s, right? 70s pastels. And then I just happened to found just some oil ones. So I might have to use that for the top.
Nice. Oh yeah. Oh, and so you're going to actually we'll be able to see you drawing and your setup the whole time. That's ingenious. You're so ingenious. Great. Okay. And Carolyn, how about you? Why don't you show us what you're going to be drawing and share your tools with us?
Well, this is my still life.
Oh, great.
Just the pot, flowers, greenery, and strawberries. And you know, the strawberries are really good because we were eating them.
Great. Well, I love your strong shadow too. That'll really help ground your work. So that's going to be wonderful. And Lori, how about you? What are you going to be drawing with? Little more. Oh, nice.
That's lovely.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a lovely October setup. Great.
And I'm going to be using, they're called firm pastel color sticks that I found in my art supplies from over 20 years ago, and some of them had not been touched.
Okay, so depending on those sticks, they might have a bit of a waxy surface on one side. So you might want to kind of scrub them on a scrap piece of paper just to get rid of that, because I've got ones that are just like that and they can be frustrating with that chalky bit. Oh, good. Okay. For myself, what I'm doing is I'm going to be working, I'll show you my still life first. So this is my still life setup. I've got some lavender and a couple, I've been darning socks because why not? We need to all keep busy. And then in terms of materials, I'm going to be working in watercolor, but also in pen and ink. So I'm just going to draw it out in pen and then I'm going to fill it in with watercolor. And I wanted to share, it seems like all of us have pretty good light sources. For myself, I did a quick sketch last night and the pot lights were giving me these really great cast shadows. And so it's because it's so dark and dingy outside today, I decided to put the pot right on top. And this is the cast shadow of all four. And this is a tracing. So this is not me struggling. I just stuck the pot right in the center. And so there's all kinds of things that you can do just to get drawing. You don't have to feel like I have to be accurate or perfect. So those are all things to think about. Okay, so our first step is going to be to just kind of sketch out where everything goes. And it could be a wide picture or it could be a tall picture. So you decide what's happening within your environment, if it needs to be wide or if it needs to be tall. It might wind up being square, and that's okay too. And I'm just going to bend mine down. I've already got a bit of a drawing and I'm just going to start fleshing it in with a Sharpie. So while we're drawing, by all means, we can kind of chat. I'd love to know a little bit about some of these paintings, because I know all three of you have art history backgrounds for this work. And if you can talk and draw at the same time, even better.
Right.
I think, you know, from our talk, we had a few things that we didn't have a chance to elaborate on, but it would be nice to, now to extend on some of those ideas.
Sure.
One of them was about the community that was in St. Ives, and Helen McNicoll went to St. Ives to study with a group that said that they were going to be training for professional artists.
Oh, neat.
And there were so many people in St. Ives, not necessarily in her group, but the Bloomsbury group were there at that time, because this is just at the beginning of the 1900s or late 1800s, and everyone was sort of going there because of the artistic spirit in the air. And so she really found a group of women in her particular study group, and some of them, Dorothy Sharp, who is British, by the way, any rate, she had a lifelong friendship with her. But it's just the sort of comforting, supporting, energetic whole art scene that was taking place in St. Ives. So okay. She was very, very fortunate to have that happen.
Right, absolutely. Well, and that's what, you know, it seems like for all artists, even though we tend to draw in isolation or work in isolation, we want to have some community to bounce ideas off and just go, why isn't this working? Or let's paint together. And now we're doing it through Zoom. So it's kind of neat that we're passing that along still to this day.
Yeah. And we didn't have to go out in the rain.
Exactly.
Oh, I can see the rain right out my door here. Lovely.
Yeah.
I have to pass on to you something that a friend sent to me when I was kind of fretting about having to create art on video.
Right.
And she said, remember the value of your artwork isn't only the work itself, but the fact that you encourage other people to find their inner artist and allow themselves to be expressive and creative. And I think this definitely applies to you, Lauren, and to you, Doris. And she said it's a hugely beneficial message at this time.
Beautiful.
Right. Yeah. Well, thank you. And it's there's one painting that we couldn't show because we hadn't gotten the license rights to it, which was a piece that I think, Carolyn, you had sent to all of us mm-hmm. of a room interior. I'm blanking the name now, what it was called.
the Ingle Nook in my studio.
Yes, that's right. And do you now have a little bit of background about that piece?
Well, I just came across this, that she was painting in her studio at that time of the pandemic in 1918.
Right.
So that here she is doing what we are doing also during the pandemic.
That's right. That's right. Well, and that would have been the influenza, right?
Yes.
I think. Yeah. So it's in the gallery and it's near some of the paintings that we actually saw today. And it is this beautiful nook, which is a fireplace with pillows. And it is a quintessential composition. It is absolutely gorgeous because your eye can't leave the space. There's so much going on. And so we recommend that you visit the gallery and go to the Canadian wing on the second floor and pass the Norval Morris. So you turn right and there it is, just right smack dab in front of you. A lovely piece by McNicoll.
Also we had an Ingle Nook set up in the salon, in the previous salon, in the Canadian section of art. And it was like a real little Ingle Nook. We didn't have the fireplace, but we had—
Oh, that's right. In the old, when we had the old salon set up. That's
yeah,
right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, I actually really liked that setup. I really enjoyed that room. I'm kind of missing that space a little bit because it was so homey and inviting.
And it was great to see the line of Canadian painters, I thought, you know, from 1850 on to today almost.
Yes, that's right. Just in terms of seeing the historical component. But, you know, we got to mix it up. We can't keep doing the same thing over and over again because we want people to enjoy the art in different ways. But I do miss it. So in terms of this drawing, a couple of strategies are interesting to maybe helpful to for you to know is I tend to try and draw the things closest first and work my way backwards. And then when I'm actually doing the shading or the coloring in, I'll start at the back and I'll work my way forward so that it is actually feeling like it's on top of. I've just put in one aspect because I just want to kind of have placeholder here. But so for mine, because I'm actually doing it as a painting, I do have to work back to front. And because I'm doing watercolor, it's one of those things that's all about, you have to kind of jump around a little bit so that you're not getting things bleeding into other things. For chalk pastel though, it is one of those things where you have the smudge factor that can really play in and wreak havoc into the drawing. So, you know, you draw it in really lightly in pencil first, and then you might turn around and say, okay, I want to start doing color. You want to be working at the opposite side that your hand is. So if you're right-handed, you would start shading from the left side over so that your arm doesn't smear everything. And another strategy too is, depending on how chalky your pastels are, you might even need to put a paper towel down underneath so that you don't have, you know, that whole transfer of whatever color you're using on your hand onto the work.
I've actually already experienced that.
Okay.
And actually, I have a paper towel right here. I was trying to be very conscious of where I was working.
Right. Well, and you know what? It's now the, all of that fuzziness is atmosphere. So don't think yep. that it's a mistake. It's just adding atmosphere to what's going on in front of you.
And I hadn't decided if I was going to keep the white vase white. So I might change plans.
It might not be white. That's fair.
Happy accidents, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I find that whenever I'm fighting something in the drawing and it's not working, you have to let go sometimes and just let it do its thing. And I find that that will be a calmer painting than or drawing than if I'm fighting everything that's in front of me. It is a balance for sure. And I think, you know, for this exercise too, it's not about a finished product that's beautiful and gorgeous and wonderful. It's just the experience of getting in there and drawing, especially, you know, Carolyn, you said you haven't done it in a very long time. And so I don't want you to have the fear of, you know, people are watching and judging and what if it's no good? And you know what, if you're having a good time, that's the important thing, you know? And if you wind up with a great drawing at the end, great. If it's not that great, well, it might just be that it needs a little bit more time afterwards. And so what I'll ask all of you to do is, if you don't finish it in our little session here, it'd be great to have a photograph of what you do finish, and whether that's a replacement picture or just you fine tuning what you had to begin with. Both are valid and both are useful. So that's what it's all about is that. And so with painting, one of the challenges is, and this is true for drawing too, you tend to have to do the not very interesting bits, like the background, whether that's the wall or the things that are behind your still life and or the things that are underneath your still life, in this case, my table. You want to get those things in first, just so that you can put the shadows and the objects on top of it. Having said that, watercolor is one of those things that it can bleed into other things. So that's why I was using a Sharpie pen, which is permanent for all of you with the pencils and the pastels. They are, you know, one of those things that's a little bit more forgiving. And you can smudge, but I would recommend that you do the smudging of your background stuff with a paper towel or a Q-tip as opposed to your hand, because your hand has oils on it and it will sort of affect the paper a little bit, and it will be harder to either lift it off or erase it afterwards. Erasing not because of mistakes, but just to kind of lighten things up that are maybe not as important as other things.
It's hard to talk and do this at the same time.
I know, it is. Well, and it's because you're using your right brain, right? Your right brain is not the language brain. It's the spatial relationship brain. And so that's okay. That's par for the course. Either my drawing isn't very good or my language isn't very good when I'm teaching. So I'm not doing too badly today.
You're doing very well.
The other thing that I found really interesting, particularly with Mary Reid's work, is the fact that she kept it very, very close. All of the objects are very close to the wall. There's not a lot of atmosphere around it. There is atmosphere, there is items, whether that's the painting behind or the reflection in the ground of the table. And it's just so interesting that she's kind of creating this tiny little vignette that is not revealing that much personality about her, other than the fact that it's very constrained and very well thought out. Like, you could tell she probably spent a lot of time arranging the flowers to be just so. And that's one of the things that I think is really wonderful about still life, is you're sort of like, you're the main creator of the space, and so you get to dictate what's in it, what the lighting is. You know, Doris has this beautiful setup with the fabrics too, right? So it's like she's really in creating an environment. And in fact, even a broader view of Doris is with all the lovely shapes in behind of the canvases and the shadow in the corner of the space. Is lovely. Like, it's like you really thought it out, didn't you?
I was actually trying to hide more of the mess in my studio.
Well, that's okay. But it's wonderful to see these little spaces that are in environments that are created. And that's why it's nice to see sort of, you know, Carolyn, I bet you're a bit of a reader, right? Is that?
Yes. A lot.
Yeah,
another lot upstairs too.
Oh, well, that's great, you know. And
lots of books in this house.
Yeah, well, that's I'm in 100% agreement. Books are so,
yeah,
the best things you can have.
Carolyn mentioned that she can't wait to get to the AGO library again.
Oh, yes.
Look what I found in the shelves.
Oh, great. Both are about the one we're looking at.
Helen, wow.
Beautiful.
Fantastic.
Oh.
These are the roses that just found to be incredible.
Yeah. Beautiful. That's
Mary Hiester Reid in 2000.
Right.
That's so I'm really happy to find these two.
Yes. Books. Yeah, no, it's when I found out I was going to be doing this, I pulled out three AGO books that are all about what the collection is, and they're all a bit different from each other. And pulled out my Canadian still life painting books, and it's nice to revisit them. I mean, you can Google, but I just love the smell of books. The ink, it's just
true enough.
Yeah. And it looks like, Laura, you've got a really lovely collection behind you there. Are those original works of art?
Yeah. One is by a Quebec artist, Giselle Comtois, and it's the Saguenay. And I do intend to get there one of these days. And two on the sides are by an Indigenous artist, Shirley Chichou de Bessige. She's the wife of Blake de Bessige, one of the Manitoulin Island, from the Manitoulin Island community. And I've had them for probably about 35 years, and I still love them.
Oh yeah, they're just wonderful. I love the fact that you have accent pillows that are sort of same colors as the hills behind you there. I think that's just wonderful.
Well, the larger painting, the Saguenay Heights, has just about every color of the rainbow in it. So it wasn't difficult to find colors.
Well, that's great.
Yeah. Oh dear. Well, sometimes things don't just go where they're supposed to go.
That's right. Well, I wouldn't mind doing a check-in and just seeing how far along people are. And so if you're either willing to hold up your work or bend your camera down, whatever works for you. Oh, holding it up. Oh, that's great. Yeah, that is just lovely, Lori. Hold it up just a bit higher so we can see the pumpkin-y component. Nice. I love your use of the thick to thin line within the pumpkins. That's really a nice way to show form. Well done.
I have to admit, I did the drawing yesterday, so it's a lot easier to sort of outline today with the color that I'm using.
Absolutely. Well, and that's the thing, is practice makes it so much easier. So drawing something more than once is, you know, you look at these artists like, say, Monet, where he's done 57 haystack paintings. Well, it's because he wants to get it right, you know, and the lighting. He's also about the lighting and the time of year and what's happening in the background in the sky. But for sure, when you're doing a drawing, you want to actually have a few opportunities with it, you know. That's a fair thing to do. And Doris, I like what's going on with yours. There's some really great shadow play in that leaf there. That's
there, that one. Yeah,
yeah, that one's
thank
beautiful.
You okay, that's good. I'm actually liking the different, like, one leaf goes one way, another leaf goes another. They're kind of pointing at each other. They're having a little conversation here, you know?
Totally, yeah. And that's actually a really fair thing to mention, because you get to be the creator of this still life, you can also navigate the viewer and say, well, I'm going to put a leaf here to make it go back into and to keep the viewer looking and not leaving, right? So you've got a really nice flow happening there with that leaf pointing down and then showing you that beautiful leaf at the bottom. That's a great combination. Yeah.
We talked a little bit about how Helen McNicoll learned to put color into shadows.
Right, okay.
Mm-hmm. And so I'm just kind of looking at this thinking, like, okay, so what color should I put in the shadow? And should it be at this point maybe opposite from the yellow, and maybe, so therefore I would go to a bit of purple?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay.
Are so wonderful, because you don't want to have, I mean, you know, it's interesting, Lori, that you mentioned that the painting behind you has every color under the sun. Well, we are only seeing the blue and the orange, which is a really nice combination because your head's blocking the rest, which is fine.
Oh, sorry.
No, I didn't. Well, okay, it's great. I like the part I'm seeing, though, too. But when you're doing a drawing, if you want to help create a homogeneous quality to it, introducing some of those colors in other areas is really a key point. Okay. So if you have a lot of greens and there's maybe a little bit of red, that would be the thing that would create the shadows underneath, right?
Okay.
So if you have a lot of oranges, then blue is a really nice complement, because I find black is really harsh, right? It's very dark and it tends to dominate, and not necessarily in a good way, because it's so cool. It can be so cool. So even if you're using black, you could add some of those colors in it. It's a bit more challenging with a chalk pastel because the black can really take over. So using color complements is wonderful. And you can make these beautiful muddy browns, like the yellow and purple complement is gorgeous because the browns are so exquisite.
I'm just going to change the water in my...
Sure, go right ahead. Yeah, and so, you know, one of the other things I was doing was trying to figure out within my composition, I did just sort of, do I want it to be wide or square? Do I want it to be tall? What's the important thing in the picture? When I have a grouping of items. And so it's, you know, if you have something that goes off of the page, then what can happen is it can actually give an exit point to the viewer. Well,
as a drawer, I want someone to look at my work the whole time and not ever leave. So I might not do that. But you can certainly play around with where things are sitting in that. Yeah, these are lovely. So we're just going to keep creating our lovely little worlds of environment here. And Carolyn, are you willing to share where you're at in your drawing?
Yes.
Oh, great.
In a pickle, but yes, sure.
If it's wet and you don't want to hold it up, you could bend the camera, but or you can blot gray. Yeah, and
I don't know where to do that.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's exquisite.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, the dark of the dirt with the really light juxtaposition of the leaves. That's just beautiful. Oh. Wow.
Very intimidating, this.
Well, and when you are doing watercolor, it is all about letting it sit and settle and letting it dry. Yeah. And then you put another layer on top and another layer on top. With the chalk pastels, the problem is that if you have too many layers of chalk, it just doesn't want to go anymore.
Yeah.
So using like hairspray or a fixative to kind of give you a bit more tooth, or switching out. Doris has the chalk pastel and the oil pastel. Oil pastels sometimes can kind of get in there and make it work as well, just to have a different texture. Mm-hmm. But it is sometimes just a question of sitting and contemplating and waiting for things to dry with watercolor. And I kind of that whole concept of watching paint dry, I don't have a problem watching paint dry. I quite like what happens when things start to solidify or bloom or move.
Mm-hmm.
And and so I think that it looks like we're actually all pretty close to kind of being done something. And so we'll just give it maybe two more minutes, because it's always nice to sort of see how the end result is.
Oh, have not even approached that, but anyway.
Well, no, that's fine. I mean, even if you want to just try and flesh in some of the other objects, I find that a white page is very daunting. And so, it's the things that are easy, like the background, maybe the shadows, the table, give you a little bit of confidence. And then you can move into the more complicated things and the detail things later. Mm-hmm. And, the blacks and the darks are easy, because you can see them, because they're sort of right in the space. The extreme lights are challenging, or the mid-tones are sort of the most challenging thing. So you don't want to put them in first, because they are harder to see. So I try and do the shadows first, which makes sense because they're underneath everything, and background things just to kind of give it atmosphere. And then by then you're really warmed up and focused on what you're looking at. And so hopefully these other aspects will come sort of naturally.
We're all concentrating.
It is, yes. Well,
there's not much time left. I've got a lot to do.
Well,
and a very simple little thing.
Yeah, well, and that's okay, and it's one of those things that it's the best escape ever, I think, in terms of you have to pay attention to the present moment of what you're doing in front of you. You can't, your mind doesn't have the ability to wander into all the other things you maybe should be doing, because it wrecks the picture. So, you're giving the gift of time to this lovely little vignette of a moment. And it's also really good for you, you're calming all those inner dialogues with making.
Well, I hope our viewers are inspired to want to set up their own still life of pretty much any objects that enrapture you. It can be, it's interesting that we all sort of picked flowers or things that were of a natural, organic nature, but it doesn't have to be. It could be, you know, your coffee mug with a tea or coffee or tea pot. It could be a stack of books, you know, if that's what interests you and engages you. It could be the corner of a room. All of those things are, you know, just anything that's in front of you. Sometimes even just drawing your hand is actually a really nice exercise.
I think one of the things that happened in our talk was we realized, like, even discussing flowers, picking flowers to not pick flowers, your garden, that privilege of having a garden, or you just make do with a little plant in your house. We realize that the conversation can get pretty huge. Yes, and big.
Absolutely. Yeah. And or what is a weed and what is a flower, you know? My neighbors hate dandelions, and that's my absolute favorite flower, because it's okay. This gift, it's a surprise. But yeah, no, it's true. All of these things are part of our everyday life, and I think COVID is one of those things that we've had the opportunity to actually watch things grow, you know, and slow down enough to do that.
Let me tell you, I actually watched grass grow.
Great. You know, and we watched how, you know, how things moved within the flag. I don't think I've ever seen spring where leaves come out of trees. It just sort of seems to just happen overnight.
Yeah.
But it took a month this time, you know, and it was amazing to just sit and watch how the buds changed and moved within our backyard. So I think we're really blessed with a gift of time that we've not been able to have, for myself anyways. I'm a pretty busy person, but to just enjoy what's around you and really notice it. Okay. So mine definitely needs a little bit more work, but I do know that we could probably do that on our own. So I'm gonna share with you what I've got going on here.
Oh, wow.
So I did cheat a little bit because I had drawn it out ahead of time, right? But I did the Sharpie and the paint today, and it does need a bit more work. The thing for blanking out, the sock holder is not quite voluminous enough, and I think I could do a little bit more with the lavender, but it's fun to keep going. All right, so if we can take a look at where you're at this stage, that would be just lovely. Carolyn, do you want to hold yours up?
All right, it might run down the page, but let's see.
Oh
yeah, that's just lovely. Cool. That really thin line in the pot is really lovely, because it just makes you look at all of the lovely strawberries below. I love the bleed in there.
And as I was saying before, they're really good strawberries.
Well, that's good. Well, savor them in drawing and in eating. How about you, Lori?
Will do.
I want to do something with the background, and I liked your comment about, it was your comment about using different colors in the background.
Yes. Yes. Can you pull it towards you just a bit so that we see? Not towards us, towards you. Pull it back. We just want to see the bottom. That's all. Nice. Yes. So your challenge is that it seems to be floating a little bit. So I think giving it some background
to kind of denote table versus sky, whatever that is. Doesn't have to be what's in your background in reality. Right. But I absolutely love the gourds really feel grounded, right? They really feel like they're sitting on something. So even just creating maybe a little horizon line and then having a different color above behind the flowers would really make it seem three-dimensional.
Table edge?
No, not down there. Your line would have to be higher, right? So, because if I've got a horizon line that's behind my objects, if it's in front of it, then they're floating in the air. So yeah, it can be, you decide where it would fit and you get to make it up, right? Your horizon can be anywhere you want it to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's lovely. Really nice. And it'll give more volume to the flowers too. If it's maybe quite dark, purple would be good, you know, just to help offset that.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. And why don't we get a closer view of yours, Doris?
It just seems kind of about color. I don't know, like all,
it's wild.
It's wild. It's pretty wild.
It really reminds me of a Raoul Dufay, actually. It really is gorgeous. I love the darkness on the right-hand side there, kind of just disappearing. And the light source on the left-hand side where the pot, the white pot is, it's a really lovely entry point into it. Yeah, it's compositionally, it's just exquisite, really nice.
It's interesting though, because I know that really you should make things a little softer, right, in the background or less.
But it's a close view. It's not like these flowers or leaves are 10 miles away.
That's true.
All 10 feet, you know, it's 2 feet or 1 foot away from you. So of course it's going to be a close view. And that's why Mary Reid and Helen McNicoll's work is really interesting, because they are really close, intimate views. You're right in their space. And we've got to be in your space too. So I thank you so much for being there. So I've enjoyed our drawing. This is so fun. I can't believe I work at the AGO and I get to draw with people. So thank you so much for being a part of today. And if you do work on them more, if you would be willing to send me a JPEG of it, then we can include that into this little talk so that people can see how much it's changed or not changed, you know, and that would be wonderful. Thank you so much. So I'm going to end our Zoom talk. And I look forward to maybe working with you all again next month.
Thank you so much, Lauren.
Okay, take
care.
Thank
you very much.
You're welcome. Bye.